Hello again, and welcome to session two, part B of this five session series. Last time, we used a story about the Dixwell and Newhallville neighborhoods of New Haven to illustrate how zoning and the laws of the 20th century established segregation in the United States, and especially in Connecticut, and how the effects of those laws remain today and retards the ability of most Black Americans to accumulate generational wealth. Today, I'll use a story about the Connecticut beaches to further develop these themes. Then I will discuss some creative ways to address these problems and ways that you can help. So you remember in the 60s, where we had these great advances, the Fair Housing Act, the Civil Rights Act, the Voting Act, there were a lot of race riots. And so why was this? And so a high-level committee was formed, composed of Republicans and Democrats, leaders in their field that know something about housing, about policing, about social services, truly a blue ribbon panel. And so the Kerner Commission report is a little more than you might like to chew on, but Jelani Cobb trimmed the report. He didn't change any language, but he edited it down to its essentials, and you can read this. And actually, you only have to read into the first third or half of the book, and you get the idea, because city after city after city, a very similar story is being told. And they placed the blame on these riots on the northern version of segregation. They concluded that living conditions were separate and unequal, and this was due to decisions that society made. Among its recommendations was refocusing police functions on violent crime and letting social agencies handle calls regarding mental health, domestic disputes, traffic, and cat-in-the-tree types of calls. This was the first version of, quote, defund, unquote, the police. Although they did not use this totally misleading term, what they meant then and what advocates mean now was redistributing funds between agencies and perhaps an increase in funds as appropriate. In other words, let police do what they do well and let social agencies do what they do well. Lyndon Baines Johnson slow walked this controversial report. With Nixon's Law and Order and Southern strategies, the report was shelved and never saw the light of day. Reading the report is distressing because it could be describing today's events and proposed solutions. So let's give a practical example. Let's look at a lawsuit in Woodbridge. And this data I took from a Connecticut Mirror report in the August 2022. And the plaintiffs wished to build a quadruplex for affordable housing on 1.5 acres, but the land is zoned for a single family home. They maintain that this zoning violates CT's zoning enabling and fair housing acts. It violates the Constitution's due process, equal protection, in anti-segregation provisions. The plaintiffs want zoning that allows Woodbridge to build its fair share of affordable housing. As we'll see in future slides, affordable housing is about 2 to 3% of the housing stock, and the state would like it to be more like 10% of the housing stock. So what are the town's objections? Increased traffic, although they have no traffic studies to demonstrate that this would be harmful. They would encourage Black and Hispanic Americans to migrate to Woodbridge. We can't have those people in our neighborhood. Why? Because without any evidence, those residents would harm their children. They would steal their cars. And it would change the character of the town. We worked hard to live in a town like this. So let's look at a parallel problem in Connecticut. And that's the access to the beaches, which again are very segregated. And while zoning reform is controversial, we are making progress on it. A law was recently passed in the legislature to put more teeth in the state's zoning laws. But access to the beaches is the third rail of Connecticut politics. You will not get any politician who's willing to spend more than a millisecond on it. So Free the Beaches, The Story of Ned Cole, is a book by Andrew Carlo. And this graphic is taken from his book. And let's give a little bit of the background. In the late 19th to early 20th century, real estate speculators bought up all the land along the coastline, save 7 miles. And they received charters from Hartford for imagined beach associations. Even though no one lived there, this was undeveloped land, these beach associations were explicitly racist, no Black or Jewish people. And so people were attracted from the cities to buy a summer home along the beach, knowing they would live in a segregated neighborhood. These beach associations were semi-autonomous from the towns in which they resided. Many of the town beaches along the shore were also exclusive. So if you look along here at the black dots, these are private-owned beach associations. Gray dots are town beaches that are restricted. Open circles are places that are not segregated. The squares are the handful of state parks that are also not segregated. In the 60s, a federal law was passed that nationalized the beaches, the shorelines. The wet beach was public property. That is, all the beach below the high tide line, or in some places it's defined as the grass line, all of that was public property. These laws also established the public trust doctrine. That is, towns that lived along the shoreline all around the nation were holding that land as a public trust. Now, Ned Cole was an activist in the 60s and 70s. His focus was on helping poor neighborhoods in Hartford and around the country. He had an aggressive, abrasive approach and enjoyed initial success, but this approach eventually led to his downfall. He founded the Revitalization Corps, which provided tutoring, job placement, fought slumlords, protested against government policies, and the Revitalization Corps spread beyond Hartford to cities around the nation. So he tried to integrate the beaches by challenging town ordinances. And he would get neighborhood children and their mothers from the greater Hartford area, put them in a bus, and just take them to some town and let them off and use the beach. The towns, the beaches, beach associations and towns would call the police and remove the kids. But later on, they would take advantage of the beach below the high tide line. The way they would do this is the bus would go to the town boat dock, and they would strap boats and rafts and so forth on the top of the bus. And at low tide, all the kids would paddle over to the beach. And since they were below the low tide line, the high tide line rather, they could have a fun day until the tide came back in. And all the residents that lived along the beach, all they could do is keep their white children from playing with the black children, much as those children might well have liked to do it. This is just the same as the Dixwell story, where many lake associations wouldn't let black skin pollute their lake, where Guilford took a different view and not only allowed black children to use the lake, but they allowed them to mix with white children. It was a collaborative effort to build this beach. So Cole invited town leaders and ministers to a meeting to explain what he was trying to do. And only Guilford and two ministers came to the meeting. And those ministers were later sanctioned by their congregations. Some towns offered meaningless solutions. We would allow, on certain days, allow children to be bused in. But on the other hand, Ned Cole would brook no compromise. So there became violent opposition to Cole's activism. Madison led a statewide fight to counter Cole's tactics. But a businessman in Madison, a Jewish person, it would seem, Hiram Birnbaum, frustrated Madison by inviting the Revitalization Corps to spend summer in his collection of beach houses. This meant campers could get a hotel beach pass and use the beaches. The response was a bit of violence. Women volunteers were assaulted, and the police just dragged their feet. Cole rented a house in Old Lyme. Children would fan out along the beaches when the tide was low. And that fall, the house was set on fire. And even though it was in sight of the fire department, there was no response for an hour. To publicize segregation along the beaches, Cole gathered a few colleagues and they hiked the entire shoreline. They started by Rhode Island and slowly worked their way along. And as they encountered various towns, they garnered a fair bit of support. But as they got farther and farther west, especially when they got past New Haven, the resistance became intense. Closer to New York City, where the wealthy from New York City would have their summer homes, that's where things really got difficult. Well, the publicity that they attracted inspired the Department of Energy and Environmental Protection to remove physical barriers between the beaches and would forbid future construction of impassable jetties. The battle between local and state management of the beaches continues in the legislature today. So the arguments used to protect the beaches and block zoning reform are similar. You may recall we talked about how these arguments sustain segregation. We worked hard to live in this community. We would welcome anyone who has the money to buy in. But of course, if the underprivileged were prohibited from accumulating generational wealth in the past, they would be unlikely to have money to buy in. We don't want to change the character of the town. Low, moderate, and affordable housing might let minorities in. It's not up to us to help to solve the housing crisis, or by extension, access to the beaches. In the case of the beaches, we pay for maintenance and lifeguards, but Connecticut and the federal government pays for storm damage. Further, non-shoreline towns pay for sewage treatment to help keep the water that's draining into the Sound to keep it clean, so the shoreline towns would have swimmable beaches. There's concern that state and federal government is taking away local control by imposing one-size-fits-all regulations. But you have to bear in mind that zoning authority rests with the states. Towns enact enabling ordinances that best fit their town, but they need to conform to state guidelines. And we'll have a little bit more to say about this as we proceed. Let's look at a typical strategy for urban renewal, using our Dixwell neighborhood as an example. And what is commonly happening is outsiders decide what the neighborhoods need, in this case, the city New Haven, and the contractors that they hired. So recently, the community center in Dixwell, the Q House, was rebuilt with outside contractors and outside labor. Now, the Q House has long been a source of community pride, going all the way back into the 50s. Edwin Williams, who helped me with the story of Dixwell, explained with pride how the community would use this facility. And in the basement were pool tables. And to play pool, you need a cue stick. And that's where the origin of the name Cue House derives. Unfortunately, the Cue House burned down several times. And the last time it was rebuilt, we got this beautiful building, but it was built with outside contractors and outside labor. Money from this investment leaves the neighborhood rather than foster local businesses and giving employment for building it. But then who's going to maintain the structure and the grounds? That's what we mean by sustainable employment. Well, while the Cue House remains a source of pride, was it developed the best way? What would be an alternative method for renewal? Because there was a lot of resistance to building this latest version of the Cue House. The community was upset and protested loudly about how this was done. So what's the alternative? So more recent efforts involve the community. For example, a new playground is being constructed. While the people who had the idea for this live outside the neighborhood, they spend extensive time, professional time, their professional lives was spent working in this neighborhood. And what they did when they came up with this idea is they asked the children, what kinds of things would they play with? And what kinds of things wouldn't they play with? They held potlucks and picnics to draw the community in, to ask what was their opinions about how this playground should be built and what should be in it and what would be most useful to them. They went to find a local contractor to help design it. And so they are in the process of raising money for it. They're about two-thirds of the way there. And so this will be a playground that the community is invested in because they helped develop it. Similarly, affordable housing is being built in the Dixwell neighborhood. And the community has some pride in this because they had some input. The city being burned when they built the Cue House learned their lesson and made a point of drawing the community in to help them develop ownership in the project. So there are a number of programs in cities across the country. I know of a few of them where I've talked to the people leading the efforts. And one is Blacks in Green, a sustainable square mile in Chicago South Side. One is PUSH, that is renovating a diverse neighborhood in Buffalo. And then there's the rehabilitation of Hunts Point, a book by Majora Carter that's in my bibliography. There's some common themes in all of these projects. The community makes all the decisions. After organizing the community, much the way the playground community were organized, green construction materials are used, community gardens, parks, housing is incorporated into these projects. For example, there are seniors in this community, and what would they like in their housing? And the requirements they need in their apartments are different from what a young family might need. And so these were all taken into consideration. Money was attracted from grants, from philanthropy, from the federal government. But the idea is that the community is in charge of how this grant money is spent. Be built by locals, some of whom would be learning as apprentice so that they could have a lifelong skill. And there would be continuing jobs. Who was going to maintain the community gardens? Who would maintain the parks? And who would be the people managing and maintaining the housing? So sustainable in terms of environment, including employment for the locals. A major goal of these efforts is to give the brightest youth reasons to stay in the community rather than define success as getting out of the hood. So clearly, we would like our brightest youth to leave for universities wherever, to follow job opportunities wherever. But we want to have a community where they would feel encouraged to return to their community and become part of the economic structure there, building coffee shops and clothing stores and choosing to run a business in their old neighborhood. The problem of the brightest leaving the neighborhood is brain drain. And so one major goal is to keep the brains from leaving permanently and have the brains return to become community contributors. Progress is being made in Connecticut. A new zoning law was recently passed, Public Act 21-29, that boosts enforcement of existing zoning statutes that towns have routinely ignored. The statute also includes new methods for increasing affordable housing. But there is resistance. Some towns fear the state is taking over local control, but zoning authority rests with the state, who delegates authority to the towns under state regulations and guidelines. You can look up the General Statutes, Chapter 124, Section 8, and see a rather lengthy list that zoning commissions are supposed to follow. These statutes give some flexibility, enabling towns to modify them to fit local conditions. One concept is as of right. As of right means the Planning and Zoning Commission does not need to approve the development. Private homes are an example. The idea is to create more instances where developments can be built as of right. One example is an accessory dwelling unit, or ADU. An ADU is a self-contained, independent living space that might be for family members or be a long-term rental for someone unrelated. ADUs are environmentally friendly because they increase housing density to preserve woods and farmland. Because ADUs must be smaller than the main house, they are less costly to build and rent. To build as of right, the structure would need to conform to the standards that each town establishes for itself in advance. Professionals in the planning office would verify that you've checked all the boxes. The Health Department and Wetlands Commission would also need to approve the plans. The only time the Planning and Zoning Commission becomes involved is if the builder asks for an exception to the preset standards. If a proposal is not as of right, the builder and Planning and Zoning Commission might have to meet several times with the applicant to iron out concerns raised by the commission. With each iteration of the proposal, architects need to redraw plans. Lawyers and engineers would need to charge for their time for each meeting with the commission. Each iteration costs time and money. By establishing clear standards in advance, as-of-right developments can fit the town's character and plans for growth and be more affordable. In June, towns submitted their plan to increase affordable housing from 2 to 3% average across the state to 10% of the housing stock. It might be better to call it workforce housing because it makes it affordable for employees to live in the town where they work. About 78% of people that work in Guilford live out of town. Of those, some cannot afford to live in town, even though they might like to. It would be desirable for our teachers, police, firefighters, those who work in our local businesses, and so on, to be part of the community. Affordable housing is defined as a percentage of area mean income, or AMI. Housing costs, rent or mortgage plus utilities, is restricted to 30% of income. Eligible applicants have incomes below a percentage of AMI, typically set somewhere between 60 and 80%. To count towards the 10% affordable housing goal, the housing has to be deed restricted. That is, you can't buy a house at reduced price and then turn around to sell it at market rates. The restriction can be set for up to 40 years. Besides affordable and or deed restricted housing, the housing stock for all price ranges needs to increase. When the wealthy can't find luxury housing, they bid up the price of middle-income housing. In turn, people with mid-level incomes bid up the price of low-income housing, which means some folks can no longer afford to live in town. A housing assessment for Guilford was performed by the South Central Regional Council of Governments, which includes much of New Haven County. It has been studying the problem of affordable housing by doing demographic studies and bringing towns together to share their approaches and brainstorm a way forward. They are the ones who revealed how the influx of wealthy residents exacerbated the housing shortage by paying more than the asking price for all levels of housing. 90% of the housing stock is for single-family homes in Guilford, and 7% is for 2-9 unit buildings. There is a desire to develop transportation-oriented communities, and grant money is available to foster this kind of development. The idea is that by increasing housing density around public transportation and local businesses, walking about town would be encouraged, which would reduce the use of cars and foster a sense of community. Transportation-oriented communities would benefit businesses who would see more foot traffic visiting their shops, public transportation by increasing ridership, public schools by filling seats in the underpopulated schools found in many Connecticut towns, including Guilford. It would help elderly who wish to downsize and limit the use of their car. The availability of affordable housing would allow them to stay in the region. It would also help our young who would like to stay in the region to start their families and careers. The community would benefit from the racial and cultural diversity that minorities would bring, if only they could find affordable housing. One concern is about the streets that might not be able to handle the increase in traffic. However, transportation-oriented communities would favor the use of public transportation and the ability to walk or bicycle to do business in town. So what's going on in Guilford? As I mentioned before, towns had to submit an affordable housing plan last summer. Guilford's plan focuses on increasing multi-unit housing along the Route 1 corridor and the area between the train station and Route 95, which includes the area surrounding the town green. The units would be near public transportation, and many would be in within walking distance of stores. In Guilford's case, development near the train station is limited by a floodplain. The Housing Committee is organizing an effort to solicit feedback and ideas from the public to flesh out this plan. This will be a multi-year project, so there's plenty of time to get involved in shaping the plan. There are three affordable housing developments already in progress here in Guilford. One of them is near the train station. Another is an 830G development. This statute allows a residential complex to be built in areas not zoned for that use. In return, 30% of the units must be affordable and deed restricted. Towns are learning it's better to negotiate with the developers rather than fight the project. Such court battles are costly and the rate of success is very low. Once a town increases its affordable housing stock to 10%, they need not accept 830G proposals. The desegregatect.org website provides background, lobbying efforts for specific proposals, a calendar of events for public meetings in each Connecticut town, and action items to help you make your voice heard. Here is the summary for parts A and B of session two. The New Deal, GI Bill, Federal Housing Authority, and predatory realtors explicitly hindered the ability of Black Americans to accumulate wealth. Wittingly or not, zoning sustains racial segregation and adversely affects all Americans directly or indirectly. Access to Connecticut beaches and zoning reform are hot-button issues, because they ask us how to undo injustices created by our ancestors. Given how many things are already in place, this is a tricky problem and will require a lot of thought. White Americans have gained wealth and power at the expense of Black Americans. The question is, how can that wealth and power be used to ameliorate past wrongs? We can begin to address racial inequities through zoning reform and increasing affordable housing. But this is not a zero-sum game. Like many efforts that address racial injustices, better zoning and more affordable housing benefits everyone, regardless of race or ethnicity. Thank you for attending the series this far. I hope you will attend the upcoming sessions where we will discuss thought leaders in the Black community from the time of the Civil War and diversity and equity in Guilford's public schools. See you then. I would like to thank Dennis Culleton from the Witness Stone Project, Joel Halender, Guilford Town historian, Errol Davis of the African American Heritage House in Chautauqua, New York, and Camille Borders, Princeton University and the African American Heritage House, for their helpful discussions. Carol Rizzolo provided help and encouragement. Edwin Williams and Charlotte Nietzsche provided stories about New Haven's Dixwell and Newhallville neighborhoods. Special thanks to Tracy Tomaselli, the historical room, the Guilford Free Library, who provided research materials and helpful suggestions. Please feel free to contact me at larry.rizzolo@gmail.com.